Hemlata ji and invite her for the speech.
Thank you, sir. Now we are going to have the next lecture to be delivered by Dr. Hemlata ma'am. She is the director of ICMR, National Institute of Nutrition, Hyderabad. Her research interests encompass areas like maternal child health and nutrition, immunology and public health nutrition. She is also serving as the president of the Nutrition Society of India and executive council member of the Federation of Asian Nutrition Societies, that is FANS. She also holds the positions of expert member of various task force committees of the Ministry of Women and Child Development, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. She is a fellow of International Union of Nutrition Sciences, fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences and fellow of Telangana Academy of Sciences. She has been honored with several awards, especially Ponduri Venkata Ramanna Rao Gold Medal, Dr. Kamlapuri Sabarmati Memorial Award. After taking over as director of ICMR NIN, the institute received the prestigious award for excellence in nutrition science and technology, that is Potion Outlook Award. We request you, ma'am, to please share your thoughts.
Good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. Yeah. Good morning to all the eminent guests, to all the eminent participants and all the NASI members. And I thank profusely Dr. Bamji Madam and Dr. Manju Madam for giving me this opportunity. So Madam gave me just 15 or 20 minutes to share my thoughts. So I'll go like a sprinter. Okay, bear with me if I'm going too fast. Okay. So here, policy implication, nutrient requirements for Indians, the RDA and EAR. And these are the two books where with this one, the blue one contains the nutrient, the macro and micronutrient composition of about 560 foods in India. And the other one, the later one, the brown one is the recommended dietary allowances nutrient requirements. So these two books are widely, we use it thoroughly for calculating nutrient requirements. So in 1994, recommended dietary allowance was the only metric that was being used globally. And from 1994 to 1997, the IOM, Institute of Medicine, US, decided to have a more comprehensive recommendations and metrics. And therefore, they evolved the estimated average requirements and then adequate intakes, and also the tolerable upper limits came. And all these together are called dietary reference intakes. Now, these dietary reference intakes have lots of policy implications because our ICDS and MDM programs also take the recommendations that are based on this are goes into the calorie and protein recommendations for children, school children, and pregnant and lactating women. Then we use these recommendations for fortification strategies and also for food labeling. Then guidance for national regulatory bodies like FSSAI. Then the government also fixes minimum wages of workers from this. Then planning of food production and planning import of food to meet the gap that is there between production and the level that is required. Now coming to this estimated average requirements, very quickly I'll tell you all, the nutrients required for normal functioning of the body is called estimated average requirements, and the various methods are used. For example, functional markers like enzyme activity for various vitamins, and then nutrient balance studies, that is input and output, especially for protein, calcium, these are very widely used. Then turnover, like stable isotopically labeled nutrients, particularly for iron. Particularly this, the 2020 RDA book contains the data from this iron and B12s particularly. Then obligatory loss, especially for protein, is widely used. And sleep and then awake energy requirements are used for calorie requirements. Then depletion methods are also used. Now remember, this is the estimated average requirement derived from population studies, but most often this study is very scanty, and even those data that are available are from very small number of population groups. Globally, the data is very scanty, and there's a lot of scope for nutrition scientists to work and develop these data. This is the estimated average requirement. Now coming to this, this estimated average requirement is the average requirement. I mean, if the nutrient requirement is normally distributed, look at this. I have given the example of iron here. Now, when we did the estimated average requirement, it came to 11 milligrams. Now, 11 milligrams is the estimated average requirement that was derived from the previous this thing that I have said, the isotope nutrients, isotopic labeled iron. I mean, the iron intake, it was studied in such a way that that iron went and lost into the RBCs for formation of hemoglobin. So from there we have distribution. I mean, some people will require higher level, some people will require lower level for the same hemoglobin synthesis. Now, depending on this, the 2SD on the right side of the estimated average requirement is what is called recommended dietary allowance. So as we move on the right side of this curve, more and more people, adequacy of nutrient is complete, I mean, fulfilled. I mean, in the center, 50% of the people, we are very sure that they require only this much. But as we go on the right side, more and, 97% of the people requirement is satisfied. But if require, intake is more, we also have a level called tolerable upper limits. I mean, up till this, chronic intake of a particular nutrient, say, for instance, iron or any other nutrient, will be tolerated. This is the upper limit up till which level it can be tolerated. But beyond this, adverse effects can start appearing. So this is the basis for this dietary recommendations, DRIs that are evaluated. And we should keep in mind, these are very important while recommending for policies or while recommending on individual basis in clinical conditions. So when the distribution is normal, it is very easy to calculate ER plus 2SD is equal to RDA. When the distribution is normal, but the data is not sufficient, then we take the help of 10% or 12.5% coefficient of variance. When the data, the nutrient requirement not normally distributed, then we log transform it and then we recalculate, back calculate it for EAR at RDS. Now, many scientists believe that the current recommendations are lower than the previous recommendations, but I am sorry to say that actually, in fact, 2000, if you have put the comparison here, 2010 and 2020, most of the nutrients are actually slightly higher than the previous recommendation from ICMR N9. So the red color is the 2020 and the black color is the 2010. If you see for males and females, the RDAs are slightly higher. It is the estimated average requirement, which is for the first time, which was developed in 2020, is slightly lower than the RDA. Naturally, the EAR, estimated average requirement, is understandably lower than the RDA. 2010 RDA, but the current RDA for all the nutrients, it is slightly higher compared to the 2010, except for iodine and niacin, both for males and females. So, most of the nutrients, we have EAR and RDAs, but coming to carbohydrates and fats, it's never EAR RDA, it is only acceptable macronutrient distribution rate. So, with respect to macronutrients, only protein will have EAR and RDAs, but total fats and carbohydrates will have only the macronutrient distribution rate. And this time when we developed the RDA, we took care to limit the carbohydrate intake to only 51, 55, and for adults, it is 55 to 58, so that we derive our carbohydrates, derive our energy, not just from carbohydrates, but also from proteins and fats in sufficient quantities to meet the requirements of all nutrients. So here, while the previous ones are all nutrient-based recommendations, which a lay person will not understand, this is a food-based recommendation, which is easy for people to understand. So here again, we evolved the food-based recommendation based on, like, cereals and millets, the energy requirement should not cross more than 40 to 45%. Currently, it is about 60 to 70%, rural and urban regions. But now we are limiting it to 40 to 45%. While the cereals and pulse ratio also has been limited to 3 to 4 cereals and one portion will be pulse. Then protein sources also, again, we took care to see that the cereals will contribute only to 1/3 of the protein requirement, and the rest of the protein should come from pulses and flesh foods and other nuts and seeds, so that quality improves. So based on this, we have recommended different groups, how much nutrients should be, how much food group based recommendations can be can go in for men and women with different physical activity levels, and also for children. In a lot of hard work went into this, we took the help of the current recommended dietary allowance and also the food composition tables and derived this, keeping in mind that the energy will be limited to 25 to 30% from fat, 55 to 60% from carbs, and not more than 40% from cereals. So based on this, when we saw how the nutrients are met based on this balanced diet, what we saw is we are almost meeting all the micronutrients from vegetarian as well as from non-vegetarian food, except the problem is with B12. B12 requirement is quite high, but we are not getting sufficient B12 from any food except for a small amount from egg and a small, very small amount from milk. I mean, milk and egg provide vitamin B12, but then the levels are very low. Therefore, even in the non-vegetarians, the flesh portions do not contain so much B12. It is only the organ meat. So when we analyze the NNMB data, what we see here is the rural people, contrary to what is being recommended, 50% of the cereal should be whole grains. What they take is just the polished fine rice and very little intake of millets and wheat. And there is sufficient, significant level of unhealthy food intake also is there, even among rural population. When coming to urban data, although refined rice is not very high as much as the rural area, it is not to the level that is being recommended here. But then their intake of unhealthy diets is considerably higher. It is up to 10% or little more than 10%, while it is about 4 to 5% among rural population. So why we should be concerned about this is fruits and vegetable intake decrease the risk of diabetes, while foods like chips, biscuits, carbonated beverages increase the risk of diabetes, while milk intake decrease the risk of hypertension. This is from NNMB data. So it is extremely important to understand that fruits and vegetables improve our health, and sufficient quantities of curd and milk products will improve our health, whereas unhealthy foods can increase the risk for diabetes as well as hypertension. Now, all of us know very well that EAR meet the requirements of 50% of the population, and recommended dietary intake meet the needs of 97% of the population. Now, for fortification strategy, we have to assess the adequacy of intake and analyze the gap, percent of population that failed to meet the requirement, and design the fortification program to fill the gap. What is the intake level? What is the requirement level? Now, to fill the gap, again, we have to debate on whether this will be with EAR or RDA. So there are two methods that are being currently being used: cut point method and the probability method. NIN also RDA was used as the cut point method. Mostly 70% RDA was used. Some people use 2/3 of RDA. Some people also use 3/4 of RDA. There's no scientific basis for this, but this is the level that is being used because it's very, very difficult to go at individual level. So there has not been a clear rationale for the selection of this level, how this is being used. And EAR as the cut point, also some people also use EAR as a cut point level. If the intake level and the requirement level overlap, then the EAR cut point method works well. Otherwise, again, there will be problems. Now, this is another type of cut point method where, if this is the requirement of a nutrient, say, for example, and this is the intake level, This is the estimated average requirement. The bell-shaped curve that I showed you, this is the line, the vertical line shows the estimated average requirement. So those people who fall on the white, this white one indicates the people who are falling under the adequacy level, and the shaded area here on the left side shows people who fall on the inadequate levels. But here again, there is a problem. There will be a small group of people, like, say, for example, this A group, where the requirements are, the individual requirements may be more than the individual intakes may be more than the individual requirements. Whereas there may be a small group of people like B, where the individual requirements may be less than, individual intake may be less than individual requirement. Therefore, there may be a small group of population here who are actually not inadequate, and there may be a small group of population here not actually adequate. So although this problem is there, if it is equally distributed, it cancels out each other. So that is the cut point method. We also have a probability approach method where we divide the population into different segments of intakes. Say, for example, here for 4.18, one group, 10 people have intakes of 4.18, 20 people have 4.18 to 17, and more than 17, another 70 people. So they divide them into these levels, arbitrarily divided into intake intervals. For each intake interval, the percent of the total population expected to have inadequate intake is estimated by multiplying the percent of the total population that intake interval by the probability of inadequate intake of that interval. Again, this is the approach that is being used, especially when the distribution is very skewed. So here, just see this one example here, the red lines here. For protein, this is the probability approach. 2.3 inadequate level. Now this is clearly matching with the 80% RDA cutoff level. Again, coming to vitamin C, you see the probability approach inadequacy level is 39.6 and it is quite close to 70% RDA cutoff level. So the cutoff level and the RDA, probability approach level and the cutoff of RDA are closely matching for protein as well as for vitamin C. But coming to iron, especially for child intakes and females, it is very different. Look at the probability approach. It is calculating 23% inadequacy level, whereas if you take the fixed cutoff approach, it is 98, 91, 81, 62. It is nowhere close. I mean, by cutoff method, we are overestimating the inadequacy level, whereas by probability approach level, it is much closer to the fact. How even the probability approach may not have, need not be so glorified. Let us come to that later. But here, I'm giving an example of how for different nutrients, how they match the probability approach and the cutoff approach. Now let us go to the next one. Here, the calorie intake from NNMB data, rural and urban, if you see, just using the cutoff level of EAR 2020, if you carefully see, look at the urban levels, 56 to 90% of the population are taking less than the energy that is recommended for them. I mean, here in coming to the rural level, a similar proportion, nearly 100% of the population are taking less than the recommended level of estimated average requirement of calorie. Is it believable? I mean, how can so many people be taking inadequate level of calorie in India? And the FAO, based on which the global hunger index is developed, also shows a similar level of inadequacy. Look at this blue color here. While the red is using the ER 2020, the blue color is using the FAO equation. Here again, it is showing very high level of inadequacy of calorie requirement in Indian population. Now, when we use the actual formula that is there for energy requirement and make all the corrections that are required, then you see the level of inadequacy in the rural and urban population. Almost all of them are actually meeting the requirement for calorie. If you base it based on their body weight, based on their age, based on their gender, based on their physical activity level, then you see only 27% of the lactating women and 24% of the pregnant women are taking inadequate amount of calories among the rural population. For this, we do not have data on the urban side, but among the rural, I mean, this is understandable. Almost all the other age groups, other physical activity levels are meeting the requirement. It is less, it is only within the recommendations of 15%, and 15% error can occur, whereas the 27% of the pregnant and lactating women have inadequate level. And here again, the calorie inadequacy is within the 20%. Within the 20% means you must understand the 24-hour diet recall can have an error of up to 30%. I mean, even these people are falling within that range of error. Again, here you look, I mean, I'm just giving one NNMB requirements. I mean, based on the ER cut point method. Again, most of them are inadequate. Almost all the nutrients are deficient. Can we believe this? I mean, if you use just the cut point method, this is the problem. Currently, we have set up a group of, I mean, this is Bhanu Prakash Reddy's work on vitamin A. Again, you see 60-70% deficiency. I think this is the probability approach that was used. So now currently we have formed a team here at NI. Various scientists are there. We are working for different nutrients to start with. We are working for iron and other nutrients. So this is the problem with probability approach and the cutoff method. Overestimates of the extent of undernutrition indicates large number at risk of apparent all nutrients, which is not at all believable. Cut point method is influenced by the cutoff standard selected. There's a lot of disturbance coming in. Somebody is keeping their this thing on. Maybe they have to mind. Now, how to fill the nutrient gap? Very quickly, I'll tell. Do you want to see that all the population go to the RDA? Fulfill the RDA? Or do you want all the people to fulfill the ER? If you see that all the people should go to the RDA, the second graph here, I have adopted this from IOM. The second graph here, I mean, there is a risk of overshooting the tolerable upper limits. Whereas if you take only the one RDA, if the median should meet the RDA, a significant proportion may be meeting the inadequate level. Now, if we take one RDA, one EAR, it seems, I mean, if 97% of the population meet the EAR, then we do not have the risk of overshooting the tolerable upper limit. At the same time, we do not have the risk of inadequacy. The risk of inadequacy is 2.5%, which is a very acceptable level. So fortification health, thiamine reduced beriberi, then cereals when fortified with folic acid first time in 1996-98, it prevented a neural tube defects. Then folic acid became mandatory in several countries. Then vitamin D almost eliminated rickets in developed countries. Otherwise, even developed countries saw lots of neural tube defects and rickets, which were all quite rampant. Canada saw beriberi. Then iodization of salt led to reduction in goiter and cretinism. And then that became global, it became a global agenda. Then India adopted it in 1960. So various nutrients really made a lot of difference in the lives of the people. I mean, for example, salt iodine in the US, goiter prevalence decreased and cretinism also decreased. Then deaths due to pellagra, just a simple requirement of niacinic acid reduced the deaths due to pellagra. Even now we see in pockets of population, especially in people who take a lot of alcohol, niacin is a big challenge. So iodine, goiter, cretinism disappeared. With folic acid, neural tube defects almost vanished. Niacin reduced pellagra and death. Thiamine reduced beriberi significantly, although it is still seen in certain pockets. But the story of iron and anemia is slightly different. Even the Cochrane review shows that maybe it improves iron status, maybe it decreases hemoglobin, but there are not much studies, large-scale studies to show that it really works. And there are a lot of bias in the study, and most of them are industry-led. From NIN, which was led by Radhika, very beautifully, this study shows iron fortified rice improved iron store and hemoglobin, but then supervised midday meal program also improved iron and hemoglobin. So supervised feeding and a balanced diet, even without iron supplementation, can improve iron status and anemia status. This was done from NIM led by Dr. Radhika. Then here, the same study also showed inclusion of double fortified salt, inclusion of fortified rice, salt and iron folic acid supplements together led to an increased risk of excess iron intake to about 40% of children. That is really worrisome. Then NI study reported by Bharati Kulkarni, lower prevalence of iron was seen in the rural population. Serum iron was adequate in rural population. You give more iron, it is not going to be utilized unless there are other nutrients to synthesize hemoglobin. That is the message that we get from this data. So calorie adequacy is also important. Without calorie adequacy, just fortification will not work. So because another study by Dr. Reddy, Dr. Banu and Dr. Raghu showed that energy intake was a strong predictor of the mean probability adequacy of most of the micronutrients. So if you want to meet micronutrients for good health, you have to meet your energy requirement, and that should come from variety of foods, not just from refined cereals like this. So that is the message I wanted to give. There are several other issues like nutrient related for fortification issues like bioavailability, nutrient interaction, then consumer related like impact, target population groups, adverse effects in different segments of population, then food related, the intake data. The most latest data is only 2016 that took from Urban. We do not have the current data. And that data also is showing mostly adequacy. The intake data on the nutrient mapping, appropriate estimation of the level of nutrient to be added. Then intake data on the vehicle, which vehicle we are going to use and what is the intake level of that vehicle and the population to be targeted. And the program also should be attached, dovetailed with the regular monitoring and evaluation of the impact of food fortification. As a public health measure, periodic evaluation is a must. Fortification strategy must be having a regular monitoring and evaluation to see the adequacy level, the impact level, and also see any possible toxicity that can be prevented. And biomarkers also should be developed to assess the toxicity levels. Then regulatory policy, labeling issues are there, claims, micronutrients and fortified foods should meet at least 10% of physiological requirements for normal population and be within a range of 50 to 30% of reference intakes. So these are the things as nutrition scientists, all of us must work together. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. for giving this very informative lecture, highlighting the importance of micronutrient requirements with reference to recommended dietary allowance and estimated average requirement of nutrition, depicting a comparative analysis of nutrient intake between rural and urban population. Thank you so much for sparing your time. Now, micronutrients have biochemical and functional basis and actions both at molecular and cellular level, and the deficiency of micronutrients manifests in the form of several diseases, including the cognitive and psychological symptoms. We are with us very renowned scientist Dr. G. Bhanu Prakash Reddy sir, who will be speaking on biochemical and functional evidence of micronutrient deficiencies. Dr. Reddy sir is a scientist G at the National Institute of Nutrition and heading the biochemistry department. His research area is related to molecular nutrition of chronic non-communicable diseases. Published over 200 research papers in scientific journals. He's a recipient of several awards, ICMR Basanti Devi Award, Scopus India Young Scientist Award, RPB International Scholars Award, and Dr. V.N. Patwardhan Prize and Nutrition Society of India Young Scientist Award. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry, fellow of National Academy of Sciences India, and fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences, fellow of Telangana Academy of Sciences, and also a member of Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, that is FSSAI scientific panel. Request you, sir, to please slide in your thoughts.
Thank you, Archana, for that kind introduction. Give me a second to share my presentation. Good morning to one and all.
Sir, it's not visible, sir. Your slides are not visible.
I'm coming to that.
Okay.
I have a problem with that. Just give me a second.
Professor Reddy, if you have any problem, you can just send the slide to us.
No, I am done with it. Okay,
thank you.
Hey, can you see the slides now? Okay, great.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and you can hear me, I think, right?
Yes, sir.
Good morning to one and all. Dr. Manju Sharma, madam, Dr. Bamji, madam, and Dr. Mohan Rao, my director, Dr. Hemlata, and I also see the Honorable President of INSA, Dr. Saha, and all the esteemed fellows of the academies and speakers and participants. I just made a presentation 1 month ago in a NASI webinar, and I was wondering what to present in this seminar, but you just cannot say no to Dr. Bamji, madam. Her word is an order to many of us. So I thought to share some of the recent data on the micronutrient deficiencies that is collected as a part of the comprehensive national nutrition survey. What I'm going to do in the next 15 minutes or so, I will show you the glimpse of this survey data, particularly on micronutrient deficiencies in children, that means 1 to 19 year old category. And I also have some slides on adults, which is a limited data. Second thing is I want you not to strain too much of the data into the slides. I will try to give the glimpse of the message in the slide. To begin with, what my director has started, these are the required components in the food. I will not take your time on the macronutrients, that is carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, but I will focus on the part that micronutrients. Basically, micronutrients are put together as vitamins and minerals. These do not contribute to the calories, but require in small quantities. That's why we call them micronutrients. Obviously, they have to be obtained from the diet, since body cannot synthesize most of them, if not all. Therefore, they are very essential in our diet. They play various biological processes as cofactors or structural components of the proteins or components of the many biological reactions. Each micronutrient, of course, has a specialized role, and they regulate many key metabolic processes in the body. I will not be able to list all of them, just to mention few, they are very important for growth, immune function, brain development, and many other functions. While every consumable food in the human diet is made of one or the other macronutrients, but not all dietary foods contain micronutrients. This is the main reason for the micronutrient deficiencies. Therefore, a diverse diet, including vegetables, fruits, whole grains, as my director showed you in my plate, and what was the situation and what is that required. So you need to have diversified foods to meet the requirements of micronutrients. However, in low middle income countries such as in ours, there is no easy access or availability of foods that naturally contain essential micronutrients. And therefore, micronutrient deficiency, usually referred as hidden hunger, is detrimental to growth, cognition, immunity, and many other health related aspects. And of course, it also is reason for several diseases such as blindness, neural defects, obesity, etc., etc. The micronutrient deficiency problem has been, you know, talked and debated over the years, and we are supposedly having more than 2 billion people with micronutrients, particularly children with micronutrient deficiencies around the world. And again, we are supposedly contributing to 1/3 of this problem, but of course, this is subject to correction with the recent data. Nevertheless, this is a problem. So this micronutrient deficiency is a grave nutritional concern, which countries to be most, you know, significant that have the problem, they face the human development. Micronutrient deficiency is primarily due to inadequacy of the diet, particularly quality diet. And as I mentioned, of course, due to minimal dietary diversity. But this extent of deficiency depends on economic, social factors, and many other things such as cultural aspects, etc. In low to middle income countries, the systemic infections and parasitic diseases also again contribute to this problem, because they interfere with the absorption and utilization of many of the micronutrients. Despite substantial economic growth in India, in recent decades, the chronic malnutrition, particularly micronutrient deficiencies, has limited its global economic potential. So, all in all, what is the status of the micronutrient status? Basically, how do you realize the micronutrient status, deficiency? Mostly clinical signs and what pathology of micronutrient deficiencies can be realized in the population according to age and sex. And are also, like, you know, it can precipitate into clinical deficiencies in some vulnerable groups like children, pregnant women, or lactating women. But probably not in all age groups. Sometimes you may not realize if it is a subclinical deficiency. So, second thing is, of the 20 vitamins and minerals, deficiencies of vitamin A, folate, iodine, iron, and zinc have significant impact on public health. And of late, we have added vitamin D and B12 to this category. Can everyone mute their audio, please, so that it does not interfere with the presentation? So, hence, studies that focus mostly, obviously, on vulnerable groups, that is children and pregnant women or lactating women, and also these vitamins that I said for the reasons that I just mentioned. But otherwise, you know, we generally do not get to know what is the status of other micronutrients in all age groups. In this background, in other words, most of the time, the clinical signs of micronutrient deficiencies represent only the tip of the iceberg of the problem. And the micronutrient status among the population can be measured indirectly through dietary assessment, as our director just mentioned, but it can also be measured by, you know, estimating the levels in the body fluids or in body tissues. But this is not often done, and therefore subclinical deficiencies of micronutrients are usually concealed in the apparently healthy population, or the so-called apparently healthy population that may be widespread. We have no idea about it. So, by and large, micronutrient status of the population at subclinical level, when I say subclinical level, which does not precipitate in the clinical situation, that kind of data is not available, except for children and pregnant women or some vulnerable groups. So in this background, recently, Ministry of Health conducted a comprehensive national nutrition survey to collect the comprehensive data and nutritional status of Indian children from 1 to 19 years age. And compared to the previous surveys focused, as I said, obviously for very younger children up to 4 years or 5 years, but this survey extended all the way up to 19 years old. Previous national surveys not collected national representative data in the age group of 5 to 14 years, though there could be some surveys on adolescent girls and boys, but not in this age group. Therefore, this survey was the largest micronutrient survey ever implemented, first ever nationally representative nutrition survey of children and adolescents in India. And also it is not just focused on a vulnerable or a clinical situation. It's a national survey. So the survey is like this. As I said, it is implemented by Ministry of Health with UNICEF, and the technical support is provided by UNICEF and CDC. The quality assurance is provided by or guided by AIIMS, NIN. One of the speakers of today, Dr. Nair, is part of this one. And many other things are taken care by Population Council. But the biological sample collection and analysis was done by SRL Limited. This thing, it is an outsourcing business, and all other aspects are taken care. So just in a second, the study design is like this. It's a community-based cross-sectional study covering the preschool children 1 to 4, 5 to 9, and 10 to 19 years. And it adopted a population proportional to size sampling design, covering all the 30 states. This is very important. That's why this is the first national representative survey. And the sample size is 1,12,000 children in all three age groups. Biomarkers analysis is done in 50% of the sample. That is almost 50,000 of the children are enrolled for biomarker analysis. Now, having said that, I will start with a few micronutrients of importance. I will focus on prevalence of vitamin A deficiency in 1 to 9 year children. Here, the cutoff is 20 microgram per DL. That is, anything less than that is vitamin A deficiency. That is subclinical deficiency. If you see 1 to 4 years, the national prevalence was 16%. In 5 to 9, it was 20%. In 10 to 19 years, it was 14%. But what I want to mention here is that all the earlier surveys before to this, we had a different picture. And anything about 20% prevalence, particularly in 1 to 5 years age, was considered as a public health significance. Therefore, we have a program called Universal Vitamin A Supplementation going on for the last so many years. And it is mandatory, it is all over. Now, with this survey, there is a rethinking on that. Because if you see, there are only 4 or 5 states which have more than 20% of the prevalence. One of them happened to be Telangana, of course. But do we need to do this for all the 30 states when it is not such a significant problem? So now Health Ministry is taking a call on that. There is a revision on this. Probably they will come to a targeted approach using the data of this one, where the problem is public health significance. That is the fallout of this survey. So this data has been recently published. And the other one is the vitamin B12 and folate deficiency. So start with folate. You have 23% prevalence from 1 to 4 years to 28%, all the way up to 36% in 10 to 19 years age group. Whereas B12 deficiency, starting from 14% to, you have all the way up to 31% prevalence. This is, I'm talking in terms of prevalence. If you see, the prevalence of deficiency goes up from younger age to higher age, particularly all the way up to 18, 19 year olds. And intriguingly, B12 folate deficiency is more in boys than in girls. So that is one thing that we may have to keep in mind, when we design some intervention programs. Now, other important micronutrient that we have been talking of late, at least for the last 10 years or so, is vitamin D. The vitamin D deficiency is 14% in 1 to 4, 18% in 5 to 9, and 25% in adolescents. But here I have to mention one point. This survey used 12 nanograms as a cutoff using IOM cutoff, but generally we use 20 nanograms of cutoff for the deficiency. If you are to use 20 nanograms, the data would be, in my view, it would be almost double. Anyway, going by 12 nanograms, this is almost 24% deficiency in adolescents. What is interesting is the prevalence of deficiency is more in urban and more in richer groups. Urban could be because of less exposure to sunlight. That is one possibility. So also the higher deficiency richer could also be because of that. One has to validate that. And some of the states like, Punjab and Uttarakhand have the deficiency all the way up to 60 to 70%, which is very, very worrisome. And another nutrient of very concern is zinc deficiency. But again, like vitamin A, here zinc deficiency, if you see a 1 to 4 national sample prevalence is 17%, 16%. But it is very high in adolescents, that is more than 30%, 31%. What is interesting is, in 1 to 4 years, except 1 or 2 states, none of them have more than 20%. Likewise, 5 to 9 years old, maybe 5-6 states have more than 20%. But very interestingly, or very worrisomely, adolescents, except two states, all of the states have more than 20% of deficiency in terms of zinc deficiency. But I'll come to this little later, what is the implication of this, whether we need to go with it or we need to do something else. Yeah, and it comes to iron deficiency, as our director already mentioned, it is higher in 1 to 4 years age group expectedly, and also in adolescents, but it's lower in adolescent boys as well as, you know, 5 to 9 year old children. And iron deficiency higher in urban than in rural. It is 41% in urban compared to 29% in rural. This is what Dr. Hemalatha was mentioning. And also it is higher in richer quintiles compared to the poorest one. There are some issues here, whether the utilization is a problem, whether it is other micronutrient deficiencies are not allowing it to be utilized properly. These are the issues that we need to address. So the summary of the micronutrient deficiencies of this survey is this: vitamin A deficiency from 14 to 19%, vitamin D deficiency 15 to 24%, B12 from 13 to 35%, folate all the way up to 38%, zinc deficiency only in adolescent 31%, iron deficiency increased in adolescent all the way up to 31%, and just to connect this to the anemia, 41% of preschoolers, 24% of school age children, and 28% of adolescents were anemic. Just to link up this to the indicators of malnutrition. Of course, this is a cross-sectional survey. You cannot talk about the cause deficiency, but I'm relating what is happening with respect to the malnutrition indicators in the same survey. In 4 to 4 years, there is a 35% stunting, 17% wasting, and 33% underweight. Whereas 5 to 9 years, it is 22% stunting, 10% underweight, and 23% thin. But interestingly, 4% overweight and obese. This is the double burden. In adolescents, you see 5% overweight and obese. Of course, at the same time, you have 24% thin for their age. So whether the micronutrients are the cause or consequence, obviously they have to. It has to be a consequence of micronutrient deficiency. But how far this is the only reason is needs to be addressed. Now, this we all know that, as I mentioned, micronutrients have various roles, particularly linking to non-communicable diseases. In the same survey, if you want to see, 1 in 10 school-age children are pre-diabetic. 1% of the school-age children are diabetic, and 7% school-age children and adolescents have chronic kidney deficiency indicator, that is serum creatinine. 5% of adolescents are hypertension, and 3% of school-age children and 4% of adolescents have higher cholesterol. So this is the situation right now we are in, and in the next 2 minutes, I just want to give a brief of the situation of adults. But unlike the comprehensive national nutrition survey, we don't have such a survey for adults. This is a small study that we have done in and around Hyderabad in a 300 sample size. It has its own limitations, but it will give an idea for us what is happening. With some variation, but you can take it that more or less this kind of situation can occur elsewhere in the country. And we have done this between 21 to 75 years age of apparently healthy adults. Out of them, 5% have the undernutrition, 48% are overweight, and very interestingly, 63% of them abdominal obesity. None of them do not realize that they have abdominal obesity. And 20% of them are anemic, 33% are hypertension. Let me give you in one slide the entire picture of micronutrient deficiencies. If you see the vitamin B12, all B vitamins, of all the B vitamins, vitamin B2, this is what Dr. Bamji Madam has been telling us, or rather she has been yelling at us to address this issue. Now we get to the point that almost 50% of the population, at least in this study, are vitamin B2 deficiency, and followed by B12, that is again close to 50%, and then B12, that is 45%. Folate 33%, vitamin D 30%. So this is a snapshot, but one has to really replicate this and see what is the implication of this one. Just to link it to that, 50% of the population have higher homocysteine, and you know that good number of vitamins like B6, folate, and B12 are some way or the other linked to the homocysteine levels, and it tells us that, you know, almost 50% of this study population has higher levels of homocysteine. You know that it's a marker for many non-communicable diseases, and it's also a risk factor for many non-communicable diseases. And in the same setup, there's 30% of anemia, but interestingly, the iron deficiency anemia is only 50% of that. That means only 14% of the anemia is due to iron deficiency. Rest of the 50% of anemia is due to something else other than iron. So this is what NIN of late has been telling, that iron is not the only contributor to the iron deficiency, is not only the factor for the anemia. There are many other factors, including other micronutrients and protein. Just to summarize this, it is quite alarming in contrast to the commonly highlighted deficiencies. All these days we have been focusing on iodine, vitamin A, D, etc. But now this small study tells you B2, B6 is problem, and it is in line with NNMB findings of our intake, and which is not commonly reported in Indian context. And this subclinical vitamin deficiencies appear normal because, you know, unless you go for it or there is a clinical situation, you do not realize. Therefore, it receives less attention. And mostly it could be because of the dietary inadequacies, and this can increase the susceptibility to infectious diseases or degenerative diseases, contributing to mortality and morbidity. As I mentioned, though it's an exploratory study, but it will identify the situation and help us to replicate it in some other places. Our director mentioned many factors to this inadequacy, but in this study, one of them, in addition to all that what Dr. Hemlata has mentioned, educational status is also one of the reasons for the inadequacy state. You see, the lower the education, the higher the inadequacy. When I say MPA, it's the mean probability of adequacy. So when you have higher illiteracy states, your inadequacy levels are also high. So with this, I want to end with what is the summary of this and take home message. With the existing cutoffs, we have used the existing cutoffs. So the subclinical deficiency of micronutrients are rampant in children, adolescents, and adults. In other words, every section of the population, particularly B2, B6, B12, vitamin D, zinc, and iron. However, we need to derive India-specific cutoffs for many, many nutrients, if not all. I will tell you why we need to do that. And what needs to be done? I think we have to focus on nutrition education about the prevalence of deficiency of these micronutrients and their consequences, about the importance of diet diversification, about the importance of the intake of fruits and vegetables and many other quality foods, and promotion of kitchen gardens, home gardens. I think Dr. Bamji Madam is going to focus our presentation on this. I won't mention much, but Poshan Maha mandate is one of these. Out of the 4 weeks, 1 week we are supposed to be focusing on this part. Therefore, this is very important for either NASIA or NIN to take it to the population. And then supplementation programs such as ICDS, MDM, or any other supplementation program should take note of this available recent data and evidence, so that we will see that whether B2, B12, B6 are there in the menus. Finally, the director has already highlighted about the balanced approach towards the food fortification, taking care that it is not going to cross the tolerable upper limits. With this, I want to tell you that recently Dr. Sachdeva has, you know, done an exercise of the same CNNS data, that, you know, wherein he has derived the thresholds for our own population up to, of course, up to 1 to 9 age groups, where it has come down by 1 to 2 grams of hemoglobin, lesser than the WHO cutoffs, which has resulted in almost 20% is less of the anemia. Now, Dr. Raghu, my colleague at NIN, started working on deriving the cutoffs for serum zinc. Once this is done, it will help us to do it for other nutrients, but some of the available data will not also allow us to do it in that way. We may have to derive our own data. With this, I will stop here, and I thank all my colleagues who are part of this, the data that I presented from NIN, all the way from my students and Raghu and Bharti, Lakshmaya, and my director. Of course, we have Dr. Anura and Santugos from St. John's, and Dr. Sachdev from Sitaram Bhartiya. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving a detailed account of micronutrient deficiencies, which is very much prevalent in our country, also referred to as hidden hunger. And you have very nicely depicted the detailed statistics and various diseases associated with micronutrient deficiencies. Thank you so much for sparing your time. For achieving the food security, people must have physical, social, and economic accessibility. The Food and Agriculture Organization of United Nations